On March 2, 1933, King Kong was unleashed on an eager public. Thousands queued up at movie theaters across the country to see the eighth wonder of the world. King Kong premiered at New York's Radio City Music Hall and the Roxy Theater, an unprecedented two-theater opening for the time.
And remember, this came out in the bottom of the Great Depression, because people think of the stock market crash in 1929. Yes, but the bottom was 32, 33. Even that was, you know, from Franklin Delano Roosevelt came in as president. This was the worst. They had to close the banks. There had to be a bank holiday because of the run on the banks. And, you know, there was at least 25% of the working force out of work then. So these were hard times. And to have this picture open up at the Radio City Music Hall and the relatively new RKO Roxy in New York and the seating capacity, which was, you know, in today, It was a big hit, and people were, you know, even though they were broke, they would pay their money to get in to see it because it was the great escape of all times.
In Hollywood, the film opened at Grauman's Chinese Theater, which was suitably decorated for the occasion.
Well, it was kind of exciting. Outside in the entrance to the theater, they had a huge head of Kong just to, as an attraction, and I stood there for a while, and while they took pictures of me with that huge, huge animal's head. When we went in the theater, it became much more real. I could tell that the audience was really liking it, really. It was a fantastic sensation to know that the work we'd done was being appreciated in an extraordinary way.
I think they had 24-hour showings. It was a sensation when it came out, and deservedly so.
My mother and myself and my aunt went to see King Kong one Saturday afternoon, and I haven't been the same since. So that shows how a film can change one's whole life sometimes. Just an inspiration, any inspiration.
RKO, wanting to capitalize on Kong's success, rushed a hurriedly prepared sequel into production. Son of Kong was strictly designed to cash in on King Kong's success. Nevertheless, everyone involved, Cooper, Shodzak, Rose, and O'Brien, strove to make it as good as they could, given their limited resources.
Yeah, some baby. Oh. You're not a patch on your old man.
No other project seemed to match the expectations of the filmmakers post-Kong, and none was more affected than Willis O'Brien.
He was the sweetest, nicest man. He never got the recognition he deserved.
In fact, Cooper and Shodzak seemed to be the only people in Hollywood who would hire him. Following Son of Kong, O'Brien supervised the special effects for The Last Days of Pompeii.
His career was very tragic as well in terms of all of the good ideas that he had that didn't come to fruition, and all the hard work that he did where he would meticulously plan scenes and then they would get canceled, and not just scenes but whole projects, whole films. He would plan elaborate things and then they would go down the tubes.
Cooper and Shodzak came to the rescue with another project about an oversized gorilla on the loose. Released in 1949, Mighty Joe Young was a happier tale than King Kong. Joe is not only heroic, he lives at the end. And the outcome was much happier for Obie as well.
And they lived happily ever after.
I sure hope so.
They will. They're back home where they belong.
Along with the creation of King Kong, Willis O'Brien's greatest triumph came at the 1950 Academy Awards, where he accepted the Oscar for Best Visual Effects for Mighty Joe Young.
Now everybody knows Willis O'Brien pretty much and knows what he's done and everything.
Like so many great artists, Willis O'Brien's achievements are revered today, but not so during his lifetime. Fortunately, his singular talents left a rich legacy of cinematic wonders.
Inspiration actually is a quantifiable commodity, because Willis O'Brien made this extraordinary film, King Kong. It's wonderful. It's almost like being a part of a secret society of people who were inspired by. And when you trace back that lineage, that DNA, to one person, essentially, and it was, Willis O'Brien. There's an enormous tidal wave of creativity that was spawned that's just still cascading onward.
I just didn't have Kong to inspire me, but I had the films that this first generation and second generation of Kong fans had gone on to make, the Harryhausen movies and the films that that George Lucas made, and you know, it's a snowball effect that compounds, and really the snowball begins with King Kong.
King Kong's maestro, Max Steiner, inspired whole generations of composers. He went on to create hundreds of memorable scores and is revered as the father of film composing.
In many ways, he invented film music as we know it today. Like I said, there was people before him that wrote music, but he defined what film music was, the so-called laws that what film music needs to be or can be.
And he became really known as certainly one of, if not the, leading composer of Hollywood history. He's today thought of as one of the great pioneers of a brand new field of musical endeavor in the 20th century.
It was Max Steiner and Murray Spivak's pioneering work on King Kong that remains the inspirational touchstone for all who came after.
Kong is the template for fantasy sound. And I know that the work I've done as a sound designer, if I stop and think about a lot of things I've done, they go back to Kong. And it's because Kong established those kinds of notes that were used for monsters.
Following King Kong and Son of Kong, Cooper and Shodzak collaborated on The Last Days of Pompeii. Cooper also produced the last project the talented couple worked on. This is Cinerama. Of the monuments they left behind, the most incredible legacy was the Eighth Wonder of the World.
They were really proud of King Kong because it was so iconic, and they had fun making it. They were hoping the public would love it. The public did love it, and it endured and endured and endured. If there was ever a link between a character in a film and an actor and a producer-director, Robert Armstrong was cast to play Marion Cooper, who's the character of Carl Denham. And Robert Armstrong died 16 hours before Marion Cooper died. Very unusual. Not even a day apart. Very, very unusual. Cooper's life was like something you couldn't write. If you wrote a story like that, no one would believe it. He loved aviation, and he loved the motion picture business because he saw them, all three of those entities, as novel and something that was fun. Marion Cooper always wanted to have fun.
It's strange because, if anything, Marion Cooper's been overshadowed by his own film, in a sense that everybody is aware of King Kong and he's such an icon of popular culture, but very few people are aware of the man that made King Kong.
King Kong is one of those films where all the elements just came together and just came together perfectly. You had the script and the story, you had the players, you had King Kong himself and the whole team of technicians that put it together, O'Brien, and everybody was just there at just the right time.
It was the forerunner of the modern visual effects film that had huge visual effects sequences that were very complex. In some cases, they didn't know how to achieve them. They were learning as they went. For instance, I don't think that they had a good sense of how long that imagery would take to create because they've never attempted something so ambitious before.
And so it opened the door to making all kinds of fantasy movies, sci-fi movies, horror movies, whatever you want to call it, you know. But they have Kong really to thank for that because that showed it can be done.
Even though there have been 9 million monster films and what have, the idea is still somewhat unique, and the way it's done. You know, there's something about that whole thing that even though people have tried to emulate it or do something similar, that it doesn't work the same way that this one does.
They all stand in the shadow because that's the picture that really did it first.
There's this constant invention, and it never lets up.
It is the quintessential Beauty and the Beast story.
King Kong remains a timeless metaphor. There is no jungle as vicious as civilization.
It just works on all these sort of primal subconscious levels. So it's a very sophisticated film.
The thing that nobody was expecting is that they would care for the monkey.
If it were just a giant monkey smashing things, at the end of the day, you know, you might have made your money back, but the movie wouldn't be remembered all these years later, would it?
I think it, as a film, it inspired more people to become filmmakers than any other film ever made. I'm absolutely certain of that fact. And therefore, you know, those people have in turn inspired other young kids to become filmmakers.
It's something great that America gave the world.
And I've seen it hundreds of times. I still enjoy looking at it and seeing it. It's something that you see something a little different in it every time you run it.
That's why Kong is still the king.